you're still tied. If you that's just to get a mortgage, even then you're still tying yourself to a death sentence of 25 years. You're 25 now. At 27, 28, you buy yourself a house because you've managed to get a mortgage. And now by the age of 50, 57, you end your mortgage. Yeah?
Mm.
You have the house.
Yeah, just about.
But that's half your life gone, man.
Yeah, just paying the bills.
Your kids are like nearly, I don't know, I'm about 27?
Yeah.
But I'm in deep that.
What is going on, guys? Welcome back to the CEOCast. I'm your host, Raheem, and today we've got a very, very special episode for you lot because I am joined with someone from the Forex industry by the name of Shoaib. Now, he has a company called Come Learn Forex. So I think the best way to introduce this to the people who don't know what Forex is, what is Forex?
Okay, Forex, in very simple terms, is when you get currency A, currency B, so this can be Great British Pound, United States Dollar, and you buy and sell. Now, if you buy it, the price goes up, you will make money. Now, here's the difference. If you sell it and the price goes down, you'll make money. So you have the opportunity to make money on either side. Now, that's for a generic public.
Yeah.
For me, it's a little different.
Why is it different?
Forex for me is me being on two screens, seeing the opportunity, making the money, spending the time with family.
Yeah.
That's for me.
Okay.
But for the generic public, as I stated.
And the perfect example you will give to people is the fact that when you go to foreign countries and you exchange your currency, how does that all work? How does that link into Forex trading for people to understand it better?
Yeah, it's very simple. You are going, let's say Pakistan. So you go, you are on the way to Pakistan, but you need rupees, correct? So you go there. You go to the airport and you see a desk with flashing lights. These flashing lights are numbers on the screen. Okay. These numbers are your exchange rate. So you will go there. Okay. I've got £100. You will go there. They will say, okay, today's exchange rate is X, Y, Z.
Mm-hmm.
And you will give your pounds to them. And they will give you X amount of currency back. Yeah. Depending on your rate. That's the first half. But all you've done there, you've purchased. You just purchased the currency, or PKR.
Yeah.
Now, on the way back, now you come back from Pakistan, you're coming back to London. Now, you got some PKR or rupees, should I say, in your pocket. You want to exchange it for pounds. Now, if the currency rate is up, let's say GBP currency rate is up, and you go and exchange your currency of PKR to GBP, you will make money. But if GBP is down, you will lose money on that.
Okay.
So it is a profit to loss.
That sort of thing, yeah. So that's the sort of dive into Forex and what it is, yeah. So let's talk about yourself. So how old are you right now?
27.
27 years old. And when did you start this?
8 years ago.
So when you were about 19 years old?
19.
So let's talk about how did you get into it?
How got into it?
You would be in just finishing A levels, just going into uni at that point.
Yes, I was literally on my last year of college.
Yeah.
And I mean, it's been a crazy journey. But last year of college, obviously, out of nowhere, I was on YouTube, I started seeing ads. Okay. These ads were interesting. But I didn't know what it was, but they were interesting. All you see is dollar symbols, pound symbols flying, and you see a guy's face on there. I said, okay, I've made this much. Okay, very interesting. Now, when I start researching into more detail, I said, okay, this money can be made.
Mm.
But I've left it as that. Yeah, I've left it as that. Now, in my first year of university, I go there and one of my friends.
What did you study at uni?
I said renewable energy engineering.
Okay.
Yeah. Not the easiest of subjects, but family, X, Y, Z.
Yeah.
That's how you have to do it. Now, in my first year of university, I believe it was one of my friends, or it was like, it was one of my friends, or it was just a random guy. I can't remember. Yeah, it was literally one of my friends, but it was a random guy with him. So he goes, oh, I've made, I think it was around about 160, around about, I don't know, he was saying 160 XYZ. Back then it was a lot of money.
Mm, said, £160?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Yeah, okay. Back then he said, I made that. I said, how long? Mm. He said, 4 hours. I
was okay. Like, oh, yeah.
Now, that's what said, okay, like this money can be made. Like that sort of money, back then you would only see it weekly. You don't see it in 4 hours.
Yeah, of course. Especially at that age, if you're doing part-time retail or something like that, you're going to see that weekly.
Yeah. I mean, back then, retail, you'd be lucky even if you had a job.
Yeah.
Yeah, back then it was all EMA.
Yeah. True.
Now, literally after that, I downloaded the Plus 500. And I believe it was around about 2 months later after he said it. That's when my grant dropped. Allah, I got £3,000 in my account. I'm a big boy. Yeah.
And so you started off your Plus 500 account with £3,000?
Yeah. Because they were getting £320. Like, I mean, I would jump at the opportunity.
Yeah, of course.
So I put in the £3,000, get my, first I started off with the 20 quid, £320. I got the hang of it. I thought I had the hang of it. And I chucked £3,000 in. And literally I had a bit more, but that's what I initially chucked in. From there, I was like, great, I'm going to do something. Guess what I do?
Blow it all.
Not just it.
What?
Guess what I do?
Don't know, you told me.
Okay. In exactly 2 months, I took it up. But it was an increment, but when I look back at it, it's very silly.
Yeah.
But when I start taking it up, I start seeing returns of like £200 a day. So, one day it was around about, I think around about 3K or something silly like that.
Mm.
And I started seeing it, and I took that account up to around about 30K. And this was exactly on DAX, also known as Germany 30. Now, I got that money, I withdrew some money, okay? And when I started withdrawing that money, I started spending on my car. I started putting kits on there, subs, XYZ. And then fine, like, but then afterwards I started to get the perspective that shit, I shouldn't be spending money because I should go into property. Everyone, my uncles, XYZ, they were saying, go property. So I'm like, okay, if I lick this trade off, I can buy a house the next day.
Yeah.
So guess what I do?
Put what? How much you put down?
I pulled the full, I think it's around about, I wouldn't say 30K.
Yeah.
I would say at that point, it was roughly, because obviously I withdrew some as well. At that point, I believe it was around about 15, 16, 17, 18K, something like that. Put it full in. Okay. But then I only start seeing the upside. I never saw the downside risk. Because everything was going my way for 2 months straight. I was literally on the winning streak.
Yeah.
I literally got a statement somewhere. Like, here, I need to find it. It's crazy. So I started literally placing my position. I was seeing good capital. This was on a Friday. So it's literally that Friday. I had like six positions. I over leveraged my car. I had six positions going on. So when I had these six positions going on, it was in profit, but it's only profit of 4K. But 4K, yes, is a lot of money.
Yeah.
But at that point, I was like, nah, that's nothing. I've made a lot more.
Yeah.
So I go to prayers. I come back. Everything was fine. I was like, oh, God's blessed me. And then I go to a calf. This was, I think it was near Stepney or somewhere. Mm. I go to a calf and then I'm eating. I'm saying, yeah, I'm loving life. I'm going to get my house. A couple of like days, literally. Then I look at my phone and it says margin call. And I still remember, I started feeling bare sick. I was like, shh, like, what the fuck? Like, what does this even mean? Yeah. I've never seen this red, like, alert on my phone. And I'm still fucking vividly, man. Literally till this day.
Yeah, that must have hurt.
It was bad.
So what, you pretty much lost it all?
Yeah, I lost it all.
All of it, yeah.
I lost it. In fact, when the margin call came in, they said that you will literally blow the whole account. But stupidly what I done, I put in 5K more in that account so the margin call don't come up.
Okay, yeah.
So now you have a lot more margin to trade. And I thought, fine. It went up, but it was still in minuses. And I went out, I don't know, it was near Galleons or somewhere. I went out there and then I look at my phone. You know what it said on my phone? Guess. -0.00.
You lost all of it again?
I lost it.
Yeah.
I lost it all. And then I was like, okay, I made some money, had some money on the side. It was an okay amount at that time. I was like, okay, I'm done. I'm not going to touch this again. I'm going to concentrate on my uni.
Just a quick one. How old were you at this point now? So you were 19 when you started. You were still 19 at that time.
I was wrong at 20, man. Okay. I was 20. It was a year after.
A year after that.
Yeah, so yeah. This was when I was in uni. Yeah.
Okay.
Because first I got introduced and then when I start going to uni, about 20, that's when I start like, you know, when you start, okay, because when you get your grant, you think you're the shit. Like,
you think the money's free.
Yeah, free money. Mm. That's when it was. And literally after that, I gave up on it. I never gave up in the sense that I was like, okay, when's the right time I would do it again? And then from there, it was literally history from there, man.
So where are we at now in terms of Come Learn Forex? What is it now?
Now?
8 years on.
Yeah, 8 years on, Come Learn Forex has turned into a massive fund.
Yeah.
This is a private fund. This is where students actually come get trained. It is a full career path, so they come get trained. The students actually do well. They come trade in-house capital. Yeah. And obviously, it just takes it from there. It's like a nice career path from there.
So just to throw a couple of questions out, because I think we need to stress upon this a lot, because a lot of people are going to be asking this. You don't sell courses and you don't sell signals or do signals of some sort. What is it exactly that you do?
We can't do signals because you have to be FCA regulated.
Yeah.
Okay. Courses, in terms of what courses are you talking about? Are you talking about courses, online courses?
Yeah.
Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah, pretty much. Because the reason why I ask this is because you see a lot of people on Instagram, you know, the traders, you know, get their course, whatever, because they're stunting and you think that it's basically the promote get quick rich scheme. So what is it that you do compared to them?
We don't do any of that. Okay. I want simple.
Mm.
We made our money. That Come Learn Forex, first we made the money.
Yeah.
Then we launched Come Learn Forex. I mean, this is fairly recent. This is last year, 2019. So we launched this just purely to find potential, let's say, students or potential traders that could come and trade the capital of that fund.
Mm.
So this is why we launched it. And yes, throughout there, we had massive, massive success.
How does that benefit you though?
Benefits me?
Because last year you would have been trading for roughly about 6-7 years, yeah? So then, obviously you're making a bit of money, you know what you're doing now by that point, yeah? So how does it benefit you when you're helping other people? Because no one needs to do that. No one needs to help anyone else learn to trade or anything like that. If anything, you can make more money focusing on yourself and doing your own trades. So where's the benefit in that for you?
Let me ask you this.
Go on.
Why do banks hire or train traders?
To make them money.
But why? Okay, but they've already got money. Why?
Don't know, but I feel like you've got a reasonable answer for it.
The diverse portfolio, diverse risk.
Yeah.
You have £1 million, £2 million, £3 million, £100 million. You are not going to be trading yourself.
Mm.
You'll be diversing that literal capital into multiple different ventures. For us, these ventures are traders.
Yeah.
For other projects that we have on. So this way, if one goes bad, the other one makes you money.
Mm.
Now, the good thing with us, our fund, is when the traders make money, we make money because they take a certain percentage of the capital after.
Okay.
So literally, that's the main aim for
Fair it. Enough. So going back to when you first started, yeah, when you first got into trading, did you know what you were doing?
No.
So when you made your first trade, you must have saw the chart. Did you know what it meant?
No.
You just put money in it?
Yeah.
Why is that?
Felt good.
You felt good to put money in it? What, did you just think it was going up and up and up, or?
Yeah, I mean, you know what?
Yeah.
The funny thing is, when you actually look at it in clearer perspective, you just make more money at the beginning.
Mm.
But then there's only so much you can make till you lose it all. It's called blackjack theory.
Yeah.
It's a common thing that they use in Forex or any other trading industries.
Do you think that's why Forex has a bad or bad stigma around it? Because a lot of people, they get into it, they lose a lot of money, and then they say Forex is a bunch of bollocks, pretty much.
Yeah.
You think that's why?
But do you know why they think it's bollocks?
Why?
How many people that have got the right education or the right, let's say, guidance before they jumped in? How have they jumped in? Either through signals or either through what?
Courses.
Courses, but who are these courses taught by?
These Instagram traders.
Instagram traders?
Yeah.
You've answered the question.
Mm.
Correct? It is literally the base fact that if you get poor or if you go the wrong route, you will screw up. You will lose all your money. And then from there, that's where your perception of Forex will change. Oh, it's a scam.
Yeah.
And this is what I want to change.
Yeah.
It's not a scam. And you can ask anyone this. What people think they can make money quickly, when people think they can make money so easily, they will keep making that until they can. But once they lose it all, they say, nah, it's a scam.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Why am I not keep getting that money?
Yeah, because I reckon there's a lot of people who get into it thinking that, yeah, I'm going to make money. And don't get me wrong, they probably do make some money in the beginning. They're like, yeah, this is great, this is great. But I reckon as soon as they lose that money within one trade or something, that's it. They're like, nah, same for me, this is dead. It's not real, it's not legit. Stop. And they start cussing it because they've lost their money and probably got irresponsible with how much they're trading.
Exactly.
So how do you minimize your risk of the trade?
Okay. So it is very simple. When I literally started, I was research developing. Obviously, my engineering background has allowed me to do this. We start research developing and see what the generic public had been doing wrong. Obviously, you will never be good as the big boys, the banks, because you need humongous amount of capital.
Mm. And we'll talk about that later on as well.
We'll talk about that later on.
Point as well.
So essentially, when I started looking into it in more detail after university, I was already in that mindset of research development. So I gathered literally A, B, C from there and see why are these people losing? And at that point, it was 90-90-90. So 90% of, let's say, retail traders lose 90% of their capital in 90 days. Now, I got this, I said, why is this the case? What are they using? And then I thought to myself, the first thing is, where is the call coming from?
Mm.
Where are they learning it from? Yeah. Now, where can you, let's say, search up Forex? What's the first thing you do?
What do you mean?
What, like, you hear about Forex. Your friend tells you about Forex. See ad. What's the first thing you do?
Research it.
But where do you research it on?
Google,
YouTube, XYZ.
Yeah.
Now, you see some informative videos that they're teaching you about it.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how you essentially get it. That's how most people get themselves. Yeah. Then you buy courses, XYZ. Mm. But the thing is, why is that content available free online?
Out of the goodwill of someone's heart? You tell me.
I wish.
Mm.
Yeah. It's literally there to lure you in.
Well, let's put it like this. It's the same way we're doing this podcast right now. You're going to provide knowledge in this podcast and different value, yeah? Someone could then say that about you. Do you know what I'm saying?
But here's the thing.
What?
My developments, my research is not available online because they're mine.
Yeah.
I don't teach people stuff that don't work.
Yeah.
I only teach people stuff that work. Mm. It's proven by my student records. You can see it.
Yeah, and the things you do yourself.
And the freedoms, my back end, before I had all of this, I've made my assets, everything.
Mm.
I've got proof there.
Yeah.
But most people that you see right now, they're trying to sell courses.
Why do you think that is though? Why do you think people are like trying to sell courses? Like what do you think?
Quick money, man.
You think?
It's quick money.
Well, how much do you think they could sell a course for?
£300, £400.
Yeah, and to the masses.
But here's the thing. This is only by taking free content online that's available online,
putting it
in their own voice,
and
their own visual format, and then selling it to you. And they package it with a nice car.
Yeah. What a stunt on the ground.
Or a nice watch.
Yeah.
That's how they do it. Mm. And who do they attract?
People like who want that sort of lifestyle.
Exactly. And who are them kind of people? Sorry to say, but who are them kind of people?
People who want money quick.
Exactly. Yeah. And then if they don't get money quick, what would they do about Forex?
Say it's bunch of bollocks.
Bollocks. And then where does the scam would come out from?
What's that, sorry?
Where does scam come out from? Their terminology of scam in Forex, where does it come from?
From the courses.
There you go.
Yeah.
And that's the whole, let's say, footprint where it starts from.
How many people do you think on Instagram are traders and actually traders?
Okay, look, yeah. I don't have to shit on people.
Mm.
Yeah. I respect, there are a few traders that I'm not going to mention their names, but there are a few traders I really respect on Forex and they are legit.
Yeah. Okay.
They are legit. But then there's some that I could just see, nah, mate, you're a baller.
You could see straight through them.
You could see straight through them.
What do you think are the telltale signs for you to see straight through them? So for someone who's looking at someone selling a course saying, you know, you can achieve this, you can get this car, you can get this watch, all that stuff with buying my course, what's the telltale signs of knowing that is a bunch of rubbish?
Number one.
And someone who's actually legit.
Number one. Very common sense, but number one.
Go on.
What have they got prior to selling the courses? What were they doing before they were selling courses? Have they got any assets? Have they got X? Have they got Z? Do you get what I mean?
Yeah.
If they're selling what they think that is working, I'm sure they would have made money before.
Yeah.
First thing. Number two, are they actually on the screens actually trading? Do their stuff actually make sense to you? Number three, are they providing some sort of knowledge that actually works? Are they providing some sort of results that works? Are the results backed up by their students? Number four, what would you say is a fourth one? A good thing from what you've seen? I'm sure you've seen
me many. Personally, I would say flexing a lot on Instagram.
That's it. Pretty much. That's the most common.
Just luring you into the
lifestyle. Yeah.
So you want to be like, I want to be like them.
Yeah.
Buy their course.
Literally.
That's that.
Yeah. Literally.
That's one thing I like about you as well, because you don't really flex on Instagram. If you go through Shoaib's Instagram, you see that there's not... Oh, you look, might be able to see there's a McLaren in the back. That's not there intentionally. He just stores it there. Yeah, but he doesn't flex properly with it. In the Forex game, where do you think you stand amongst your competitors and people on Instagram who, like I said, they stunt and stuff? Because you're... I wouldn't say you're low-key on Instagram. You've got a lot of followers. But like I said, you don't stunt. You don't flex. So where do you think you stand? Do you think there's a need to?
No, I just show my milestones that I achieved.
I
just show my milestones, look, I achieved this at this point of time.
Yeah.
It's mainly just for a timeline, so you can see the success from this year, 2017 onwards.
Yeah.
It's not like every day I'm snapping this. It's just like, look, I've done this. Congratulations. Tomorrow when I look back at it, I pat myself on the back. Well done. But now you have to do something bigger. It just to showcase the milestones.
So let's go back many, many years now. So we're talking when you were 19, 20 years old, yeah? So we talked about how you got into Forex, how you got it. Where did you start to learn how to actually trade properly?
When did I start? This was literally in my second, third year of university when I started going in more detail. Because I took that little break, fine. But when I started going in more detail, this is what I was talking about. I was researching. I couldn't find anything valuable either back then. Trainings, you need a lot of qualification to have these trainings. Either you need a lot of capital, like, I mean, about 10K, 20K to get professional, let's say training for that. I didn't have jack shit. To be honest with you, I didn't have nothing like that to do that. So it was literally just starting from the ground down, using my head, using my degree. I mean, yes, it's not in the same industry, but using the same concept just to apply it in a different methodology.
Yeah.
Apply it in a different way. And then from there, this is when I introduced, and literally I'm the founder of Accuracy Based Trading. And this is what I found, and this is where my edge came. And I just developed it day in, day out, year by year. And even now I'm still developing it, man.
So just to break that down, what is Accuracy Based Trading?
Okay, Accuracy Based Trading, very simple.
Yeah.
It's when you place a trade, you maximize your upside gain, so your profit, and you minimize your downside risk, so your losses. We call it RR, risk reward ratio. Risk reward ratio, what's your buying to losing risk. So where normal people, they target 1-3, 1-2 or 1-1. We target of 1-5, 1-10, 1-20. Is a ratio.
Yeah.
So what that means, if it's 1-10, let's say you're willing to lose £10 to make £100.
Yeah.
So tenfold times 10.
Mm.
So if you do lose that one, which is £10, if you lose £10, you just lost £10.
Yeah.
Or if you lose that £10 10 times, you only need one trade
to make it back.
So that's where and obviously what we do, we like to catch. Here's a tip, yeah. For the people that know about trading, the way we look in the market is very different. Okay, I don't want to go into too much detail because it can get very confusing for some people, but you may understand it. So the way that generic public traded through trend lines, patterns, X, Y, Z, okay, that's... it's free content, yeah? the way we look at it, how the actual institutions trade. Okay. So the way the institutions trade, they look, there's value at this point, then there's fair value. Now, can we go up, take the price higher to catch and see how much demand is in that area? Yeah. So they're just moving them. Remember, there's two parts of this. There's the big boys, which is the institutes, and then they're retail traders. Okay. These are the two factors.
So what are retail traders?
In generic public.
Okay.
The generic public. Now, like what people don't understand is the institutes that move the market, they drive the market.
Mm.
Retail traders can't do it because it's literally 6.6 trillion or whatever the current price is literally 6.6 trillion last time I checked.
Yeah.
Dollars. And that's how much the market is valued at.
Yeah.
So it's moving that much at a time.
Mm. And actually, when the institutions and the banks are driving that money through, they can drive where the market
they
goes.
Can drive. They're the ones that control their price.
Yeah.
So we look at that, where are the most likely to go to? So we find that direction using our strategies. Fine. Now you're in the direction. Now what's the best way to break it down? Now for the people that are trading, they look at multiple currency pairs. Oh, I could trade this, I could trade that, I could trade USD CAD, I could trade USD JPY, I could trade AUD JPY.
Hmm.
But the thing is, you're trading so much. Why are you trading so much of that? So the way we do it, we look at the currency pairs itself.
Yeah.
So, okay, this is how much, let's say, value it can bring up. So we call it in pips is the daily, let's say, movement. The movement is measured in pips. Mm. So if we say GBP USD is moving 150 pips in a day.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, whereas USD CAD is moving 50 pips in a day. Now, if we look at them, just by looking at what holds more value, 50 pips movement or 150, where can you make more?
Probably 150.
150.
Yeah.
So what we say, okay, if there's 150, that's the currency pair that we want to trade. Mm. So now we've got that currency pair there. Now we say, okay, if the big boys are taking it in that, let's say, upside direction and is moving 150 pips in a day, what we can do here is we could find where price will come for the lowest, because the market goes up, then goes down. It's a pullback, retracement. Mm. So when the price goes up, we look for that pullback down. So we're trying to buy the cheapest price possible. So when they pull back, we try getting the cheapest price possible.
Mm.
And then from there, we know, because if price breaks that level and it goes anything lower, then we know it's very likely that price can turn the other way. But if it goes up from there, there's a very good chance it could go up from there. This is where the risk rewards say. So they say, this is our price. Let's say 1.32 GBP USD. We're only willing to lose, let's say, £10 at this point.
Yeah.
But it's fine. Now, if it does go in our favor, it can make, let's say, £150. Yeah? So 150, let's say £150. So are you willing to lose £10 to make £150?
Yes.
There you go. That's accuracy-based trading. In the most, I mean, I could go in detail, but this is how we look at it, and this is how we break it down in the most simplest form possible. I would go in more detail, but that's for another.
You know, the mad thing about it is the fact that you said you would go in more detail, like there wasn't enough detailed enough. But what I want to say is that I know a lot of you comment saying that I interrupt my guest, and there's a reason why I didn't interrupt you right there is because I wanted you to all see how knowledgeable he is in Forex. Because there's, like I said before, there's a lot of people who scam, and I know Shoaib is legit because I've been trading with him been learning to trade with you for about a week or two now, and I can see he's legit. When you come to the place and when he shares the knowledge and the strategies that he's got, there's no question about it. So that's why I wanted to do this podcast. I want to take things a few steps back here. So because obviously we've talked before, you lost your money in uni, yeah? You lost about 30 grand or something like that. You waited a couple of years, and then you were saying to me that you went ghost and you started again. So let's talk about that. Why did you go ghost?
Okay, look, obviously I come from an Asian background, and it gets tough in there.
Yeah.
Okay. Literally, once I was in uni, I was literally, because I've told you second year, first year. Now, in my last year, there was a lot of pressure on me.
Yeah.
The pressure in the sense that, are you getting a job? Are you getting a job? Are you getting a job?
Mm.
But getting that job, fine. Because what you have to understand, the degree, everything that I've done, it wasn't because of my choice. It was because I had to do it because of my family.
What, did your family make you do that degree or like try and drive you in that career path?
I wouldn't say they tried driving in the career path, but they said that you have to do a degree in, let's say, engineering because this is what you're most good at.
Yeah.
You're more, because they're technical, either you're technical, analytical, whatever. I was more technical, yeah. They're hands-on. So you have to do it in there. It's good. Then they chose like, okay, do renewable energy because you're future-proofing yourself. It's all about the future.
Yeah,
you're future-proofing yourself. So I've done it in there. Now in my last year, literally, I had so much, like there's a lot of pressure in there. It was a bit crazy. So I done my degree. I said, look, here's my degree. I'm not going to listen to anyone. That was the worst experience of my life. Don't get me wrong. I took some value. Like, I'm not saying don't go uni. I'm saying go uni will help you man up a lot. If you're not manned up, it will help you man up a lot. And you will learn a lot of stuff that you will not learn in college, school, XYZ.
Yeah, of course.
And
you learn a lot of life key skills 100%. In uni. Even though I didn't finish uni myself, you learn a lot in
100%,
uni.
100%. Yeah. But now it's different. Yeah. Back then, it wasn't different. It was everyone's doing the same thing. Yeah. If you're doing, like, let's say you're doing apprenticeship then, like, what the hell is this guy doing, man? Fucking failure. Like, that's what they thought. I'm going to be very rude. That's what they thought.
It's basically like the stigma of, you know, you're doing your BTEC kid, you're going to do an apprenticeship. That's the sort of thing it was.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, literally, that's what it was. So I finished my uni. And I was like, you know what? Now's the time. I turned the switch off. I went ghost for my family. Not my mom and dad, but my other side of family. I went ghost for a full year. And when I came back,
they saw the McLaren. Okay, no, it wasn't McLaren.
That came after.
What did they see then? What did they see in that time, in that year when you disappeared?
They saw success that would never, that they, couldn't their comprehend. Minds couldn't comprehend.
Yeah.
Because what you have to understand here, the normal, the average Asian or any other ethnicity, I could be wrong, I'm just saying it from like, from
your
who I am. My perspective, that they want to go to uni.
Yeah.
Or they say go to uni. But you're getting yourself into debt. Okay. After you come out of uni, they say, get a job. Then they say, get a house.
Yeah.
But reality is most houses that you could get, you can only get your mortgage. Because you can only get a mortgage, what is a, sorry to say, but what is the meaning of mortgage?
What do you mean?
What is the meaning of mortgage?
I don't know.
Mort?
Yeah.
Mort? Mortry?
Yeah.
Death sentence? Okay. You're literally tying yourself with a damn death sentence.
Okay. That's one way to put it.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
I mean, sorry to put it this way, but essentially that's where the word comes from. Now, when you look at it in that sense, you technically are tying yourself into a death sentence of 25, 30 years.
Of course.
Okay, you finish your university at 25.
Yeah.
Yeah. You're already in debt of, I don't know, 30K?
Yeah. 45K.
Yeah, 45K, easy. Now, what is the average salary when you come out? And you know what pissed me off?
What?
These guys, like, I thought I was going to get a 50K job. These guys had the cheek to offer me 18K.
Yeah.
And that's what put me off. That's why I went ghost. But the same concept applies. That the average job that you get, even as an engineer, yes, your engineer, wow, is a big thing, but is 18K or probably less starting off pay for the generic public. And literally, when you have such a thing, I mean, how much debt are you going to pay off? Like, come on. First, to get the house, you need to have some sort of like 50K saved up.
Yeah.
A normal house in London is how much? 450, 500K?
Yeah.
Half a mil? You need 50K at least there.
Yeah.
Where's that guy going to get it from? He has to work 3 years. 4 years, 5 years, 6 years.
Then he has that. Saving all of his salary as well.
Yeah, that's if he's saving all his salary. Yeah. Or if he's lucky, his parents will give him some money.
Yeah.
But even then, you're still tight. If that's just to get a mortgage. Even then, you're still tying yourself to a death sentence of 25 years. You're 25 now. At 27, 28, you buy yourself a house because you've managed to get a mortgage. And now by the age of 57, you end your mortgage. Yeah? You have the house.
Yeah, just about.
But that's half your life gone, man.
Yeah, just paying the bills.
Your kids are like nearly, I don't know, I'm about 27?
Yeah.
But I'm in deep that.
Yeah. You know, that reminds me of the whole reason why I started CEOCast is to literally, because that is a prime example of the 9-to-5 trap.
Yeah.
Literally, you're stuck.
You are stuck.
Mm. So in that time when you disappeared, what did you do?
Research development, man. I went hardcore in research and development. Mm. I wasn't looking back.
For Forex?
For Forex.
So even though you lost a lot, you still thought, you know, I can make it back.
I don't care if I lost it. Yeah. I would just say, well done. When you make a loss there, you should never say, oh, it's a bad thing.
Yeah.
But because when you look at it years ahead, you're like, oh, that was a good thing because I learned from it.
Yeah.
But that tiny loss that I made, yes, it was gigantic back. But if I never learned the mistakes, I wouldn't be where I am right now.
Of course, yeah, 100%.
And the lessons that I've learned, if I didn't know that at that time, I would probably be losing 300k at a time.
Fucking hell.
Yeah, yeah. This is why everything, there's a process, everything happens for a reason.
Everything's a life lesson.
Yeah. And literally at that point, once I reach development, I slowly start to build. I build my capital, I start trading. Once I start to get a decent amount of capital, it's like, okay, now let me buy an asset here, asset there.
Yeah.
So I start buying these assets. Fine, beautiful. But then there's only so much assets you can literally buy.
Yeah.
But how much gain are you going to get out of there? Yes, you put in rent, this and that. But how much would you actually get from it?
What sort of assets are you talking about, though?
Properties.
You're talking about properties, yeah? Okay.
Cool. But there's only so much you can get. Yeah, it gets boring, I'm going to be honest with you. Mm. Then once you have a lot of capital, you're going to invest into, like, you can't just have everything in property, man. Come on, like, you're putting your eggs in one basket. That's shooting myself in the foot.
Yeah.
From whatever I said. Literally, that's where I started divesting my portfolio. I was like, okay, what I'm doing right now, something's working. Now, how can I change that? Like, in terms of how can I safeguard my investments?
Mm.
That's when I developed everything else. So that's when in 2018, it was quarter 3, quarter 4 in 2018. That's when I started developing everything for this training program. Based trading, and I've got all my knowledge, but this is the thing. I knew most of my clientele, most of the people that were going to get this opportunity, they weren't going to be, they may not be the smartest, but so I had to get all that data, I had to dumb it down, and I had to make it so that someone from a very basic level can understand it, even from a pro level as well.
Someone like me.
Yeah.
Because when I came on, I didn't know anything.
That was the aim.
Yeah.
And this is what common Forex is about. It's not just about, let's say, Forex. It's about providing the opportunity for that individual, giving them the right education and the training, and then let them go onto the career path where they're more free with their life.
Yeah, 100%.
They can make a lot more.
And you know one thing I love about what you're doing right now, because like I said, I've been here for a couple of weeks training with you and alongside some other people who've just come down because they want to learn as well. And the beautiful thing about it is people come from all different backgrounds who are trying to change their lives. For example, I was speaking to some people, they could be coming from a drug dealing background or a fraud background or something like that. And they're finding a way to legitimize themselves because most of them, or some of them anyway, have got criminal records. Or they just haven't got the correct educational grades to get a secure job. So what's the thing they do? They come here.
Yeah.
How does that make you feel? The fact that you can change people's lives like that.
When they see the expressions on their face when they actually make the first profit.
Yeah.
That's what makes me feel wow.
Even if it's only like 100 quid or something like that.
100 quid to even a pound, man.
Yeah.
Like money's money, profits.
Mm.
Like I'm going to be honest with you, I've trained, like believe it or not, I've trained individuals from surgeons, engineers, doctors, accountants, policemen. What was the other guy? He was AI coder, it was robotics or something like that. Literally every single, and from low as a 66 year old, to a deaf person.
Mm.
I've done them all.
Yeah.
I've literally done them all. And they all learned the same thing. And I've seen every single person's success is different, no matter who you are. So it's worth, for the people that want to try it, it's worth a try. But you have to understand, you're not going to get rich overnight, man. You have to treat it like a proper job, man.
Yeah, no, because that's what, like I said, a lot of people think it's a quick, get-rich-quick scheme. Yeah, and you even showed the graph to me because we were looking at it over a year, how much you can make starting off with £1,000, yeah, £1,000. The first month you make, bearing in mind, Instagram traders advertise the fact that, you know, you can get a Lamborghini overnight. In the first month, you only make £300. But then in that first year, you get roughly about 23 grand. Now, how does it go from £300 first month to 23 grand in the whole year?
Let me ask you this.
Go on.
How did Warren Buffett get rich?
Investing.
And doing what? One technique he used.
Don't know, you told me.
Power of compound. Biggest mistake people make, they look at how much they can make the next day.
Yeah.
They never see the power of how much they can make in the next 3 years.
Long term, yeah.
That's where they screw up.
You think that's a big problem in this industry as well?
Big problem, man. Every single person.
Mm.
I wouldn't say industry, because there's some good people in industry. I would say, sorry to say it, but most people nowadays, younger than me, my age, or a lot younger, they want to get rich overnight.
Yeah.
It's not going to happen. It took me 8 years.
Yeah.
To be where I am now, and still I'm not where I want to be right now. Because there's all these levels, see this film, man.
Yeah, of course.
Literally, that's why that's there. Welcome to the next level. There's all these levels. You're all this jumping on levels. That's where it is, man. It's sorry to say it, but you're not going to get rich overnight. You have to treat it like a proper job. Treat this as university. Treat this as college. You've done your degree. Now, you're not going to get a 100 grand job overnight. No, you have to put time, effort.
Mm.
It's not that much time that people think, yeah, you have to sit in front of the computer screen all the time. It's not that. I just spent 2-3 hours in a day just doing this. But because I know what I'm doing.
I want to ask you something, yeah. So going to 2-3 hours a day. You spend 2-3 hours a day, let's just say 5 hours max, yeah, on trading. Trading is a thing you can do very mobile. You can do it on a laptop at home. You can do it in your bed on your phone. You can do it when you're out at a restaurant, yeah. Why did you invest in a unit like this, an actual trading floor?
Okay, I get this asked a lot, yeah.
Because it's a very big expense.
It is. I'm not going to go into detail how much it costs, but it's yearly. I mean, put it this way, 3 years down, you could probably buy a house. It's that expensive to run. Like, you'd be surprised. Mm. People underestimate it. Now, the main reason behind this is, number one, if you trade off your phone, what sort of discipline do you have? You trade at home? What sort of, I mean, don't get me wrong, I don't want to talk bad about anyone, but when you trade at home, what sort of discipline do you have? But when you're trading in an environment where everyone's actually working and everyone has a common goal and actually everyone's doing a similar thing, like, what vibe does that bring to you?
It's just full on positive energy, isn't it?
Full on positive energy.
Yeah.
It's like when you have people, like-minded individuals with the same goal, with the same background of what they want to do, when they're in a hub of where they can do it, they can perform a lot better.
Yeah.
Because I'm going to be honest with you, the way the mind works, you go home, you start feeling tired, there's not so much good. The way it should actually be, you go in a room, in the next 5 minutes, you fall asleep. But the reason why people can't fall asleep in the room, because they got a habit of going on the phone, X, Y, Z, this, that.
Yeah, for real.
You go home, you relax. You come work, you work. This is the working place. This is the trading floor. This is where you work from. This is where you earn, learn, make your money. And literally from there.
And the best part about it is you separate your home life compared to your work life.
100%, man. 100%,
proper important.
I mean, back then when I wasn't, trust me, it was a bit crazy.
Wow, what sort of thing?
Yeah, it was crazy, man.
What, mindset wise?
Not the mindset, but family wise as well. Your wife don't want you, she don't want you to come in because they come in late. Your parents don't want you in because they come in late. What does that show you about your other siblings?
Yeah.
How do that take away? Like, they don't see the grind behind it.
Yeah,
they think you're out with the boys. I mean, all of that stuff mentally as well. Like, literally, you have to have a right balance, man.
Of course. 100%.
You have to, otherwise, you're going to get fried.
So, throughout your journey, where do you think your big break was?
What, breakthrough or break?
Sorry?
Yeah, breakthrough or break?
Break, like big break. Where do you think you thought, right, I can actually make this a full-time career and I can do this for the rest of my life.
My last year of uni, man. Last year of uni. Because
Would you mind answering this? How much did you make in the last year of uni? Because at that point, you'd been trading for about 3-4 years.
Yeah.
How much would you have made in the last year of uni?
It was a lot, man.
Are we talking in the 4 figures, 5 figures, 6?
I will give you a rounding number.
Yeah.
You're talking close to 150, 200K.
Okay.
At that time.
Mm. What did you do with that money? Being 23 years old, max, what did you do with that money?
I done a lot of stuff with it.
Because when you're young, you're more likely to blow it.
Yeah, yeah.
So what did someone do with 100 grand?
I don't know.
23 years old.
I don't know that shit. But it wasn't the sense of I was spending the wrong way. But this spending a holiday, this and that, this and this and that.
Mm.
You know what it is? You can only spend so much until like, okay, now how much I'm going to spend?
Yeah.
Because I'm going to be honest here, I wasn't really about the designer life. Back then, the best designer for me was Adidas Nike.
Yeah.
That was the high-end designer for me. I got all that. Gucci, it's not all that. So there's only so much you get because that's when I start investing into property. Like, let me chuck into property. Prior to that, I did chuck into a few developments, that's what I said. But that was only a small amount of capital.
Yeah.
But then after that, once it's a large capital with 100K, I've had that, then it grew to 200K, 300K, 400K, 500K, enough to buy these properties outright. That's when I was like, raw. That was a breakthrough. Like, that was a massive, like, it was a big thing, man.
Yeah.
It was a massive, massive thing, man.
Throughout the time that I've known you, yeah, you've always stressed upon one thing and mentioned it quite a lot, is that you've got to be mentally strong-headed for this game. Why is that?
It's simple, man. Look at the people that won the lottery. Why have we heard about it?
Blown it.
Why?
Because they don't see that money before. They haven't seen it. Yeah.
That's why you have to be mentally strong.
But even when it comes to the trades.
Yeah. Same concept applies.
Mm.
You might make a mil. You might make 100K. You might make 10K. It's still the same value. For each individual, the value is different. Like for you, 1 mil might be like 100K.
Yeah.
I don't know. Like, I'm just saying.
People value money differently, obviously, yeah.
Yeah, people value money differently. Now, the thing in trading, you have to have a very strong, like, mind. Like, I mean, this you develop over time.
Mm.
But if you crumble, you crumble, you're screwed. But if you're a strong-minded individual, it's very, very important. Now, here's the thing. The reason why this is so important, if you make money, if let's say you have a good, let's say, quarter, you made 100K, you've never seen the money in your life.
Mm.
How easy did you make it?
Quite easily.
Yes?
Yeah.
So what will you do?
Spend it quite easily.
That's it?
Yeah.
And then what are you going to do?
Lose it.
You spent it or you lost it?
Yeah.
Then you want to do it again. You want to make, because you made it so quickly, you don't value it. You spend it. You do whatever the hell with it.
Mm.
And then you keep wanting to get the 100K back. Shit, I had 100K yesterday. Now I don't have it because I made a bad decision. It's fine. Let me make it again. Then you take a lot more risk to make that capital back. You lose it again.
Let's just say, for example, instead of putting £10 down in a trade, you're now saying, oh, you have lost that. Yeah, let me put £1,000 down.
Yeah.
And then you've lost that.
Yeah.
And then
now you're screwed.
Yeah.
You mentally go down. It's a vicious cycle.
Yeah.
Mentally, you start breaking down and then you start thinking all the negative aspects. Remember, the more negative you are, the more negative energy you're going to attract, man.
Mm. And you've basically got to learn to have that stop point.
Yes.
Yeah.
This money, it means nothing. I mean, it's essentially, what is it? It used to be the coupons for gold when you used to put it back in the reserves back in the days.
Mm.
This is just coupons, man. It's like fake, like it don't exist. It's just money that's there is like to buy you materialistic items. That's literally what it is, man.
You mentioned a couple of things earlier in the podcast, yeah? So you mentioned about future and you just mentioned money now, yeah? What's your opinions or what's your take on crypto?
I'm invested heavy.
Invested heavily, yeah? Bitcoin?
Yeah, I mean, I had to do something with the funds, man.
Bitcoin, exactly.
I wouldn't say Bitcoin. I would say there's much better alternatives out there than Bitcoin. So I'm not one to give advice, but this is just my two opinions.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm just going to stress that now. Me and Shoaib, well, especially not me, but Shoaib, we're not giving any advice. You lot are free to do as you please.
I'm just giving you my two takes and what I've done. Listen, it might shoot me back on my backside, but or it might not, or you might not just see me again.
So when did you first come about of crypto?
Crypto was back in 2017 as well, 2017-18. The bull run, but I wasn't, I'm going to be honest, I wasn't really into it, man.
Yeah.
I wasn't really into it like that. My brother was, Huzaifa was. Obviously, you soon find out who they are. But they were more into it. They made money and they took some losses, X, Y, Z. But only recently, like last year, literally, I started to take more interest in crypto. But not in the sense of how much money I can make. What is crypto is essentially is a technology behind it that will be used to revolutionize a certain aspect of the future. So that's what crypto tokens are. So I start looking in more detail, like, okay, this is very interesting. This crypto, because remember, I'm an engineer. My background engineer is all about problem solving. Yeah, this crypto solved this problem. This crypto solved this problem. This crypto solved this problem. Wow. First thing I thought in my head, shall I make a crypto? And then I was like, no, at no point. So literally this March, COVID came down and it all made sense to me, man. Literally cryptos were rock bottom. Like when I said rock bottom. And that's when I said, okay, I got funds money. I don't want you chucking into property. It's a bit risky. I don't really know what's going to happen to the market.
Yeah.
So I like, boom, banging out, yeah. Stocks were going down. I was like, let me invest in crypto. Crypto hasn't moved. So I literally invested, I think it was around about 18%, something like that, 18 to 90% of my funds money, which is essentially my money, into crypto.
And which one to be exact?
Okay, I'm not going to say the name, but it has a very good use case. Yeah. I believe this has a very good use case, but I haven't just done it into one. I've done it into a few that I believe that will revolutionize in the next, but I would say anywhere from 2 to 5 years, I would say it was like crypto market will boom because they got clarity on it.
Let me just stop there and ask you why you won't say which ones.
Because everyone will start buying it. And I'm going to get done. Like a signal, isn't it? Like, I don't want to shoot myself in the foot.
Okay.
Like, I'll give you my two takes on it.
Yeah.
But not on the cameras.
Okay.
But yeah. When COVID start coming around, like put it this way, the way I think of it is a bit different, and I want user to think of it like this as well. Okay, COVID came fine, XYZ stuff happened, bad things happen, but what is, without saying too conspiracy, what is the main agenda behind it?
Well, behind COVID?
Yeah, obviously most things that happen is money related of some sort.
Yeah.
Yes, people, stuff happens to people, X, Y, Z. Obviously I don't want to go in more detail than that. But when I saw that bright spark is, I was going to Starbucks, okay? And I gave her a £20 note. She said, I don't accept cash. I was like, what? You don't accept cash? What do you mean you don't accept cash?
So this is probably just after lockdown then?
When this was recently, man. This was this year.
Yeah.
This was this year. And I was like, what do you mean about you don't accept cash? They just dawned on me.
Yeah.
This year just dawned on me. Bro. Like, they're going cashless. They're going digital.
Yeah.
That they're going digital. Firstly, cash. Eliminate that, but slowly. But look, right now, go to any shops. How many people are accepting cash right now? Very few.
Yeah, very few.
Big businesses have literally stopped. It's card payments. Why have they increased? Why contactless has come out? Apple Pay has no limit. Contactless from, I think it was like...
£30.
Yeah, £25, £30 is going up to £45.
Yeah.
Like, why? They're getting you used to... Obviously, this much to take. They're getting you used to the digital wireless currency aspect. They're getting used to that.
But where do you think crypto fits into that? Because
right there.
But you could still have your online banking as normal money.
Yes.
The same way you have it right now.
And but it's all digital.
Yeah, of course, yeah. But it's not crypto then, is it?
No, here's the thing.
What?
You might be thinking crypto as Bitcoin, yes?
Yeah.
Bitcoin, oh, they can buy and sell. No. There's use cases of crypto that links X currency to X currency.
Yeah.
Or they solve a certain problem. So when it becomes digital, like talk about CBDCs, XYZ, it gets so long, but they need crypto, they need digital tokens there to interact with. They need, okay, now let's say if they want to go cashless, they want to get rid of cash. They get rid of money. Like if the dollar collapses, they get rid of cash.
Mm.
What currency are they going to use?
Crypto.
Crypto, like if they go back to gold standard and they start using gold standard, I'm just giving my today, if they start going back to gold standard, they have to balance it out with something, because right now gold and currency, they're back.
Yeah, they align with each other. Yeah,
they align with each other. They say, now if currency falls out of the water and gold comes out, what does it have to be backed by? What's the next best thing? Sort of
coin.
Crypto.
Crypto, yeah.
Crypto, digital assets. It doesn't have to be like Bitcoin, XYZ. It could be anything in the crypto thing that best suits it.
Yeah.
But, and I really, really, really believe in the next 2 to 5 years, this is when you start seeing everything forming, man.
So, in March, you invested into crypto, yeah? We don't have to say which one, but how much was it? As in per coin?
I would give it away, man.
You're not going to give it away?
It was in the pennies.
It was in the pennies.
Right now, if you see it, times 110%.
Okay.
From the price that I bought, yeah.
No way.
Yes.
So have you still got your money in it?
Of course, I'm holding it for the next 5 years.
Did you not cash out at all?
No. Why would I? I don't need that money.
Yeah.
I don't need that money. I want to see 100 mil. My goal, like every person has a, let's say, they have a number that they want to live by. My number is 100 mil, 500 mil. Now I'm going to see by the age of 30, 40, 50, I don't know when it's going to happen. What will it take me? What steps what risks do I have to take to get to that point? So this was one of it. Okay, I'm going to invest. It was a very large, I mean, you could buy a house with that sort of capital. I'm going to chuck it in.
Yeah.
And if it does go my way, if it goes up like how I tend it to, I'm happy to hold it. If it goes up, you're talking about mills, man, like, knows, and that's my, okay, I made my money, I'm out, man. Like, you ain't gonna see me again.
And if it doesn't, then what?
I don't care. I've got my assets. I've got my fund.
But then you would have lost pretty much, like you said,
only 20%?
Yeah.
So what? House? So what?
You're saying so what? Like there's nothing.
Okay, yeah. Look, this is the value for other people. Yeah. Like, for you, it might be something. For me, it might be something.
Mm.
For me, at that point, I know a property can be bought at any time for investment. But for other people, it might take them 4 years, 30 years. It's different.
Yeah, for sure.
I don't, like, the concept of I want to buy a house is out the window. I don't give a damn. I will sleep on the sofa if I have to. But still, I want to make sure, like, before, like, I go away, I want to hit my target and then go away.
Yeah, it makes sense.
Like, that's my vision. I mean, in life, like, if you don't make 500 million, then even if you walk away with 10 million, so what, man? Money's money. Still in the mills.
True. So if you lot follow me on social media, you know that I ask you a lot of questions for the podcast, for Shoaib to answer. But before we get there, I just want to ask you, how did you develop your strategy to become successful in Forex?
It was very simple.
Mm.
What other people doing? Just do the opposite. Because in 1999, if someone, people are losing, just if you do the opposite, you're actually winning 90% of the time. And just develop it like that. It's simple as that. Just the way of thinking in the different, like...
Different way.
Different way, man.
Yeah.
If you think of a different way, you find a solution to your problem.
Yeah.
That's how you make money in this industry. In any industry. Any company that comes out, the company that we make the most money is the person that have found a problem and found a solution for it. Okay, it's different if you make the problem and then you have the solution for it. That's a different story. Yeah. For the most people, it's
that. No, that makes sense. That makes sense. All right, so time for the Instagram questions. Is Forex a hype?
It is.
How so?
It is in the sense that everyone wants to get rich quick.
Mm.
And they see everyone getting rich quick.
Yeah.
They're buying cars, watches, Gucci, Selfridge, whatever. So it is a hype for community, but reality is you won't get rich quick.
Next one. Best way to get prepared in Forex, and what's the ideal balance to start with?
Good question. I do balance. I would say £500 to £1,000 is good, as long as you manage your risk. Best way to get started in Forex, start looking at all the basic aspects, okay? Just get start getting used to your terminology, X, Y, Z, and then you... I would say you do what you think is best for you. Like, you go to someone, like if you want to be a surgeon, you go to, let's say, you take a surgery degree, or I don't know what it's called. You do that degree as a pathway.
Yeah.
So go to whoever you think is good. I'm not showing materialistic stuff, X, Y, Z. Go to whoever is good and get guidance from them, get training from them, and then take that path.
Cool. Did you ever try signals, and would you recommend them?
I've tried signals. It's...
Yeah. I'm guessing you tried signals in your early days.
I have, yeah. Very early days. It's not worth it. It's not worth it.
Why is that?
You just lose money, man. I mean, I could go in the game of how these are make money in signals, the dirty game behind it. I mean, what is it? If you're affiliated with a brokerage, you get commission XYZ. These brokerages will send you signals. These so-called traders will literally forward these signals and get you signed up. They make money from affiliate XYZ. But these brokerages are giving you the signals you forward on. Essentially what they're doing, they're gonna give you good signals when you make money, then they give you one bad signal when you lose your money. The problem is, it's a never ending cycle. Then the end goal is you lose all your money. And when they
hedge, they get your money, obviously. Makes sense. How much time does it take out of your day?
3 hours. 1 hour a night. 2 hours in the morning.
How can you do 1 hour a night if the markets are closed?
Yeah, it's not closed.
Isn't it?
You just analyze at night.
Oh, you analyze at night.
You analyze at night, and then in the morning you spend like 2 hours, like I would say at most, just actually executing and just looking up on the trade.
Cool. Basic question, is it real?
Yeah.
That's it?
Oh, obviously, yeah.
Reliable traders and who's reliable to purchase training courses from. Stay tuned at the end because I've got something for you. Could Forex become a full-time job and how hard would it be?
100%. You have to treat it like a full-time job.
Mm.
100%.
Even if you're just starting out?
Yeah.
Why is that?
I mean, not when you're starting out. I should say once you get the hang of it.
Yeah.
When you're starting, like if you're in university, college right now and not doing nothing, and you do Forex, and because you're relying on one source of income, which is Forex, you will trade more aggressively and you take your losses in more, aggressively. Like you want to make the money back quick. But the thing is, if you have a job there or part-time and you're making money from there and you're learning Forex on the side, when you do take a loss, it won't hurt you as much because you're not using it as a primary source of income. That way it allows you to mentally feel at ease and grow much
with the compound interest, exactly. Yeah. When you're already in Forex, what's the main things to look out for?
Look out for it. Now, when you look out for something, it is a very broad thing that you're asking. Like, what specifically?
I'm guessing when to execute a trade.
When to execute a trade? Here's a tip: execute as the cheapest price possible. But you have to, if let's say it's an uptrending market, find the cheapest price possible. Obviously, I can't go in more detail. Find the cheapest price possible. You can use certain tools and use that as your entry point.
Cool. Do you teach institutional trading?
Yes, we do. We don't trade institutional. Like, you can't teach institutional trading. Because to trade like institutions, the big boy capital trillions.
Yeah.
But we can teach you concepts that we believe work in current state of, like, current time.
Yeah.
That work for the institutes.
Basically, someone just said, I assume most of the traders on Instagram are scams.
I mean, you can see it for yourself.
Yeah, fair enough. Why do Forex traders constantly harass and pester people when seeking new clients?
Go on Instagram, hey, do you want to take my course? Hey, do you want to do my signals?
Yeah,
simple. I mean, that just says it all, isn't it? Like, you know, most of my clientele, they come word of mouth. Mm. I don't have to advertise that.
Yeah, and that's the thing. You don't do no sponsored posts. Like I said, you don't flex on the gram. You don't show off. You don't do none of this.
That's why half a user probably haven't heard of me.
Yeah. How long did it take for you from the beginning to actually start making a living where you know you can actually live off it properly, pay your rent, buy your cars, buy your watches, whatever you need to do?
So to make a living, obviously, you have to become consistent. Yeah, that's obvious. In my first 3 years, I wasn't really consistent. But when I started seeing the consistency, it took me around a good 3 years to become consistent, man. And that's when I started seeing everything.
What broker platform would you suggest?
There's a few. I mainly use IC and Advantage. Those are the main two I use.
Cool. I think we kind of answered this. What other investments do you have apart from Forex, but your assets and stuff like that, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, yeah,
yeah. Cool. So yeah, random question. Next potential car.
Next potential car. Next potential car, I would say SVJ or SV. But after that, I've got my eye on the Koenigsegg. My Koenigsegg, I'm coming for you. XR.
Fair enough. Heard that real traders making real money ain't got time to, ain't got time nor interest in teaching Forex. Is this true?
Yeah, it's true. But if they have a fund, then you should divest their portfolio. So they're killing two birds with one stone.
Fair
so
enough.
They're trading, teaching, everything else at once.
Any advice for a kid that just come out of high school?
Yeah.
What's that?
Number one, don't look at what other people are doing online. Social media can be a very bad influence.
Mm.
Just continue with your studies at least to college and then see what you want to do from there, man.
So that's the end of the podcast. I hope you all enjoyed that. Please follow at Raheem KA and at CEOCast. Make sure you subscribe. I need you all to smash that like button. Stay tuned to the end. This is the end, but stay tuned. Anyway, follow Shoaib at his Instagram. Do you have Instagram for Conlon Forex as well?
Yes, I do.
Yes, so make sure you follow both of them. Now, for the juicy bit.
So as you can see, it's a different day, different clothes, different suit. And unfortunately, the footage at the end of the podcast got corrupt. Now, I'm kind of glad that I did because I put a sneak peek out on Instagram and that done stupid amount of figures. I know you lot have all been excited for this episode and it's finally here. Hope you all enjoyed it. But let me get straight to the point, back to the juicy bit of what we were saying earlier on. That's to do with the collaboration between CEOCast and Come Learn Forex. I'm going to let Shoaib take it away and explain more.
You know what? This love and support that we have, or we got, we want to choose three people to take our training. First one, we are going to choose by looking at our Instagram post. Yeah? So head over to CEOCast and write why you want to get trained. To learn, yeah, put the balls right there. Yeah. Why you want to get trained by CLF and how it will benefit you as well.
We want to know how it's going to benefit your lives, how it's going to change it, the impact it's going to have. We want to know if you're actually going to do this for a long time because it is an expensive course. We're not going to say how much it is, but go on the Come Learn Forex website and you'll be able to see how much it is. So we really want to make sure it's directed for the right people.
What about the last two?
The last two, that's interesting. Basically, all you have to do is comment the same thing, why you want to be trained in the YouTube comment section. Just let us know why you want to be trained and how it's going to benefit your lives. So the same thing you're doing on an Instagram post, do it on the YouTube post as well. Like I said, up to three people, or like Shoaib said, up to three people are going to have a course with me in December and Shoaib. Obviously, I'm no pro, but he is. I'm going to be here learning with you guys. And if anything, if you do want to meet me of some sort, you can. I'm going to be here in December time, so let us know. The winner is going to be announced. When's it going to be announced?
The Instagram one, it was Wednesday.
And the comment one, we will do Friday?
Might as well.
Yeah? So I'll go on Instagram Live on CEOCast account on Friday the 20th at roughly 6 p.m. On there, you'll see me and Shoaib in here, in his place, picking the comments of who's going to win it. It's going to be just who's got the best comment and who we're going to think is going to benefit the most. So good luck to all of you. I hope you lot are creative with your answers and do some sort of thing. I don't know. I want to see what it's like. Other than that, I'll catch you all on the next episode of CEOCast. But before we go, I just clocked on that. I forgot to ask you the famous question. That is, what does success mean to you?
Good question. Success is different for everyone. Okay. I don't think I've reached the level of success that I want to. So I will keep striving until I reach it. Then I'll let you know.
You know, that's the first time someone's ever said it like that, but I respect it. You know, he feels like he's not successful yet, so we know we've got a lot more to see from Shoaib and Come Learn Forex. That being said, now I'll catch you on the next episode of CEOCast.